Are you looking to work in a dynamic school district that not only educates students but promotes professional growth? Then come out to Pearland ISD's Job Fair on Saturday, April 13th from 8:30 to 10:30 a.m. at Pearland High School, the Searcy side. Applicants will have an opportunity to talk to the hiring campuses and departments while enjoying a cup of joe provided by Scooter's Coffee. Need a sitter for the job fair? No problem. Turner College and Career High School students have you covered. They are providing childcare for applicants with school-aged children. So get your resume ready, polish up your shoes, and make your way to the Pearland ISD Job Fair on Saturday, April 13th, and be a part of what is building Pearland proud.
Having a stake in producing productive members of society and having a hand in what becomes in the future is rewarding. Seeing that growth, whether that be academic, social, behavioral, there's nothing like it.
Welcome to the Building Blocks Podcast. This is a podcast devoted to highlighting the people and the programs that are the building blocks of Pearland ISD. As always, I will be your host, the proud superintendent, Mr. Berger. Our goal over the next 30 minutes is to give our listeners, parents, students, and staff an inside look at who or what is building Pearland proud. Today, we are going to discuss probably one of the most important topics in Pearland ISD, how to become a teacher. We can't build Pearland proud without quality teachers in the classroom. And here to help us inform us on this topic are two experts from our Human Resource Department. Please introduce yourselves and tell our audience a little bit about yourselves and what you do here in Pearland ISD.
All righty. So thank you for having us. My name is Araceli Sarabia. I'm the certification specialist here in Pearland ISD, and I'm basically the gatekeeper of making sure that our teachers are properly certified to serve our students. I've been in education for 7 years. 8 years have human resource experience, and 7 of those years have been in education. So I am well-versed in certifications, the requirements to become a teacher. So if you guys have any questions, I'm here.
I'm Shayla McGrew, Director of HR.
Soon to be Dr. McGrew.
Oh, I love that. I am Director of HR, so I do what I tell people are all the things. It could be employee relations. It could be documentation. I can answer questions about compensation benefits, certification, as a sidekick to Araceli. I have a unique background when it comes to HR. My path was a little different. I taught first and fifth grades. I was an AP, a principal, and then I've been a part of HR for 3 years.
And they are an amazing duo, and today we are going to talk about this very important topic. The first question I have for you is, how does one become a classroom teacher? What are the educational and certification requirements to make that magic happen?
And so I'll go ahead and answer that question. Well, that's a very good question. We do get that question asked a lot. So there's a traditional pathway. The traditional pathway is, let's say when you're a child, a kid, and you're saying, what do I want to be when I grow up? So that's going to be the traditional way, when you go into a 4-year program, university program, to specialize either in special education, secondary education, or early childhood education. You basically go to university to complete this bachelor's degree in education, where it will later lead you into being certified in one of those three areas, which is early childhood education, special education, or secondary education. So to basically sum it up, in order to be a teacher, you have to have a bachelor's degree with a specialized certification in the subject that you're teaching.
The director is quiet, so apparently we have that question answered very well.
Certification is the Araceli Show.
The Araceli Show. That's going to be the next podcast, the Araceli Show. Okay, so for someone like myself, I did go to the university. I was on the 6-year extended plan. It is okay. But I didn't go to get my teaching certification. So some people do that. They go a course, so they go a pathway, they go a career, and they're like, you know, I don't think this is it. I really want to be a teacher. Are there any specialized training programs or alternative certification pathways available for individuals that are looking to transition from a poor career that they picked to the greatest career in the world, which is being an educator?
And yes, there is a way to do that. Let's say that you're an accountant, and one day you decide that you want to be a math teacher. Because, you know, numbers, accounting is not working out. You want to go ahead and make a difference in the world of kids. And so that's going to be going through an alternative certification program. you do have to go through a TEA-approved alternative certification program, where basically this program, what they'll do is they'll review your transcripts, they'll go ahead and check to make sure that you have the courses that are necessary for that specific certification that you're going into. What happens is that you'll have to pass a content exam, and it's very technical, but you'll have to pass a content exam, complete some requirements in order to be eligible for a statement of eligibility, and it's going a little bit into the technicalities of it. But basically what happens is that you pass a test, you complete requirements, you have a year to be in this intern certificate to basically learn how to be a good teacher, how to get the tools that are needed to pass this pedagogy and responsibilities test, which is the second test that you'll need in order to be certified, fully certified with the standard certificate. So once you have a full certification, you've completed all the programs, you're basically a teacher. So it can take about a year, maybe 2 years. It just depends on the rhythm, how many courses, how long it takes you to complete those requirements that the program has for you.
And in that process through that alternative certification program, while if you went through the university traditional pathway,
yes,
you get kind of student teaching experience.
That is correct.
In the alternative certification pathway, you're kind of on the job training.
Yes, you do need to complete some observation hours and some courses before you do have that intern certificate to be actually in the job. But yes, it is in job experience. A lot of programs have advisors that come and watch you, basically observe you to say, hey, this is what you need to work on, or you're doing a great job in here, or basically to just give you the tools to grow as a teacher, because we all know that, you know, teaching can be tough and it's a rewarding experience. And I know that if you haven't been a teacher before, you know, it does take practice and time to be an expert in that area.
And in the field today, what would you say is the split between traditional pathway to teaching through the university and then alternative certification? What would you think that are?
I would say that now it's probably 25% traditional, 75% alternative. A lot of people are going into careers and finding out that maybe that's not what they want to do, that they want to go ahead and go into teaching because it is rewarding. But there's also benefits that come with being a teacher.
Like touching the future.
Yes.
That is the benefit. So with that, it is rewarding, but it can be difficult. And some people may have some fear because, you know, they watch the news and teaching profession is, you know, all the teachers are leaving and it's so difficult to be. Students are different. You know, who wants to be around teenagers all day? I do. How does Pearland ISD support a new teacher in the classroom with either academic or classroom management skills and training?
So what I love about our district is we believe in supporting you before you even step foot in the door. So our take on new teacher orientation, what we call Welcome Week, provides new teachers with sessions, and I say new teachers, but also new to district teachers, provides them with sessions tailored to curriculum and teaching, special education, implementation of accommodations and modifications, technology. We have a wealth of knowledge to share to build their knowledge base, but we don't stop there. Support can look different on a campus. It could be assigning you a mentor teacher as a new teacher to provide that guidance and support. I do think support can come in many forms. Our departments prepare and provide support as well. They have mentoring and coaching models where they visit the schools. They can observe the teacher in action and then give feedback, or they can model best teaching practices for teachers and allow them to observe and then have a debriefing session. So our goal is to support and let people know that support is ongoing. What we don't want to have happen is the support or the feeling of being supported to fade over time.
Because teaching is a craft. I mean, it truly is something that you perfect, whether you are a first-year teacher or you're a 25-year teacher. You should always be learning and growing in the craft of teaching, because the students that come into your classroom aren't the same. It's not the same kid. You may have 25 kids in that classroom, and each one of those students needs something special. And that's a little bit intimidating for some people. And another piece that's intimidating beyond the academics is classroom management.
Right.
Having the kids come in, and I can barely control the two kids that I raised. Needless to say, if I have 25 kids in a classroom, how do I control them and make sure that they learn? And we give support in that area as well.
Absolutely. Well, what we focus on is continued development and to make sure there is growth, not just in our students, but also our staff members. And so everyone, myself included, has an annual appraisal where you'll hear about the things that are going really well, but then also hear about, I won't call them deficits, but areas to grow. And so for some people, areas to grow may be curriculum-based. For others, they may be in the area of discipline management. it. But you'll get that feedback. You'll get some really good guidance about what to implement in your room, hopefully to show your growth in discipline management and show growth within your students in your class. We do have a wealth of knowledge on campuses, in our special ed departments, seasoned teachers, for those that are experiencing some difficulty in managing discipline, they have support as well.
So something we often hear about public education, because, you know, State of Texas had, what, $32 billion in excess and did not give any of that to teacher pay raises.
Right.
Shout out to senators and representatives. Well, we've all heard public school teachers did not get paid enough for the jobs they do. What is Pearland ISD's compensation for teachers, and are there stipends or incentives or a way for teachers to earn more than the base pay?
Absolutely. So for a zero-year teacher, your first-year teacher, the pay associated with that is $60,500. However, there are opportunities to earn stipends on top of that. But it all depends on what you do, what your role is. So for coaches, there are stipends for sports. For those that may sponsor clubs in the older grades, there are stipends for that. Maybe serving as a department head or a team leader, there are stipends for that. However, when it comes to incentives, our district chose to be a part of the state's teacher incentive allotment, which incentive is right there in the title. So it incentivizes staff to be able to really focus on their student growth, but also their performance as a teacher. Both of those things combined can have them earn designations as either a recognized exemplary or master's teacher. Now, the lower one, the recognized teacher designation, can earn you anywhere from $3,000 to $9,000 based on the district in which you work. So that incentivizes staff. So I will say thank you to the state for that. And thank you to our board and superintendent. Our board and superintendent for giving us a go on being a part of teacher incentive allotment. Now, for teacher incentive allotment, you have to be a teacher in ELAR and reading and math for grades 4 through 8, and then English 1 and 2 teachers and Algebra 1 teachers. So when I was a fifth grade teacher, I would have been all over that. However, as a first grade teacher, I would probably want to ask, what about me? Because you're excluded. It's really tied to progress measure and STAR testing. And for the younger grades and even some of the subjects in the older grades, that does not exist. So there's an option to pursue national board certification. So there are 25 areas in which you could be certified. It's got everything from PE to science to counseling to world languages. So there is an option for those that maybe aren't in the TIA bucket to be able to earn compensation as well. Because what our state did too was to say, you know, if you take the initiative and you engage in this professional development, we will, after you're certified, honor you as a recognized teacher. So you will get that designation just like you participated in TIA. So you're also eligible for anywhere from $3,000 to $9,000. Caveat, you do have to pay for national board certification. There is a $75 registration fee. And then you have to pay, if I'm not mistaken, around $500 per module. There are four. That's the drawback. But the fun fact is it's all reimbursable except for the $75 that you paid to register. So paying $75 to earn thousands is a pretty sweet deal.
Pretty good investment. Correct. And with the TINAA, right now we went through the process and are going through the process to be calibrated and certified and approved for that. And it did go through STAR for growth measures, but we are looking for other ways to extend that to the other grades that may not have STAR, because we want to maximize the incentive our teachers can get. And I have to give a shout out to our school board. Pearland ISD does more with less funding. We do not get as much per student funding as other school districts, but our school board constantly pushes the envelope of how much compensation can we give to our staff. And so I give kudos to that. We continuously give out, and to our community who approved the VADER that allowed us to give additional compensation this year. We want to value, we want to recruit and to retain our staff. And, you know, we are late into the podcast and we have not had a Producer Mac interruption. I looked in her eyes. It looked like she wanted to say something, but she stopped. So we will see.
I think all this information is very important. I was one of the alternative certifications myself. So I was in radio and television, and I ended up getting my alternative certification through Region 4. My question is everything online now, or do you still have those alternative certifications where you're actually sitting in class? Because I did, And I liked that. I liked being in a crowd where you could feed off of one another instead of being behind the computer. Now, granted, some classes are great behind the computer, but are there still certification classes where you're with other individuals?
So as far as I know, a lot of the certification programs are online where you complete everything online. And I think that had to do a lot with COVID and, you know, it changed a way of doing a lot of things online. I haven't worked with a lot of programs who have in person. A lot of the programs are going through online.
Because also the flexibility, because if you are going alt cert, you may already have a job or a career. And so you need that flexibility for online to help you transition into education.
Yes.
Right. Because I did it at night. So I was there. But I was going to say, and this may segue into your next question, but as a teacher, one of the big incentives for me as a mom was to have my summers off, was to have my Christmas off, my Thanksgiving, spring break, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, those were definitely some incentives to be able to be with my kids when they were off.
And now, that is true, but I want to make sure our teachers know that I have your back. That gets pushed back a lot, that, well, you're off on summer, and you're off on Christmas, and you're off on spring break, and what a teacher will tell you is, I'm not really off. I'm grading papers, I'm doing lesson plans, I'm planning, I'm taking care of things. Yes, it is nice to have the schedule with our kids if they are in the same school district, but teachers put in a lot of hours outside of the traditional school day to make sure grading is done, lesson planning is done, meeting with parents, volunteering for clubs, doing PTA, hosting dances. Now, our producer, Mac, may not have done that, but I know that other teachers did.
Hold on. I did. I had students who would compete and stuff like that, so I would go on the weekends, and I would definitely pay my dues that way, but it was fun too. You know, it's those teachers that have that passion to put in those extra hours and extra work. So, but you can go on, Berg.
So what would you tell someone? I mean, I'm going to do a little soapbox here. I feel like the teaching profession, based on some of the political rhetoric that is out there, has been taken down a notch. The reverence of being a teacher, the pride of being the teacher, the shots that are happening in public education sometimes are gone towards the teacher verbally. What would you tell someone if they ask you, what makes teaching an attractive career choice?
I would say, as a former teacher and campus administrator, it truly is the profession that begins all others. I mean, I've had that, you know, around me in the midst for what seems like forever, because I'm from a family of educators. So I would say, on your, I don't want to say worst day, but on a challenging day, just being mindful of, you are helping to create the future leaders, maybe some future teachers in there or some campus administrators, but having a stake in producing productive members of society and having a hand in what becomes in the future is rewarding. Seeing that growth, whether that be academic, social, behavioral, there's nothing like it.
And I can say that, you know, it's the relationship that you build with those students. Me, myself, I still keep up with my Spanish teacher. I actually invited her to my wedding. My husband's actually, you know, working with her right now because he's a teacher. He's been a teacher for 10 years. So I also see that in the day-to-day life that he has, that I have, you know, going to games to support the students, being invited to graduations, university graduations, being invited to quinceañeras. You know, it's really impactful to see that, you know, what you're doing with those students. You know, maybe sometimes their homes are not a safe place or a place where they have that, you know, where they can talk to and tell them, hey, I want to go to school, especially sometimes coming from a Hispanic background. You know, your parents may not have the education that the teacher may have. So there's a lot of questions, a lot of teachers that bring, you know, answers to those questions that those kids may have because they want to be something in life. So just that connection with the students that they have.
And that's truly the magic. I mean, I talk about what happens in the classroom and our buildings, and it is magic. When you have those moments where you have a frustrating student in the classroom, like myself was, and you struggle to learn, you struggle to grasp the concept, but then when the teacher doesn't give up on you and the teacher pushes through or finds a different way to present it to you, and you as a student have that aha moment, that is special for the student and that is special for the teacher. And there's nothing that replaces that. That magic moment of learning is irreplaceable. And so if you truly want to be a difference maker, teaching is where you need to be, and Pearland ISD is where you need to be. So we are going to switch from talking about how to become a teacher because we want to learn more about you. This is something we do in our podcast called Rapid Fire Questions. Answer them to the best of your ability. What is your best high school memory?
I think for me, it would be being involved in all the different organizations, you know, FFA, Spanish Honor Society, National Honor Society, making those connections with other kids, other students, people, and just, you know, enjoying that high school life, because once you're out of high school, you're not going to get that back. So that would be my best high school memory.
And that's a huge shout out to our current high school students. Don't just go to school to go to school. Get involved, get engaged, do something beyond class.
So as she said, I was a French horn player, so I'm a band nerd. But it's scoring ones when you go to regional contests. It's hanging out with your friends. It's everything you mentioned about being involved in clubs and all of that. But also, much like we mentioned about teaching, my little support system of friends, I still have friends to this day that I went to high school with. So I will not quantify it. But all these years later, post high school, we are still very close.
All these years later, do you still play the French horn?
I tried to breeze over that. No. I do not.
Now I'm still playing the French horn.
No. What you don't use, you lose, unfortunately.
Yes, ma'am. Who is your greatest inspiration?
So for me, it would be my parents. My parents always growing up have always said, you know, aim higher than what you think you can do because you can do anything that you put your mind into. So my parents have always been there to support and push us, me and my siblings, to do what we need to do, what we want to do, to accomplish great things in life. So
for me, James and Lola, my first teachers, my parents very had such high views about what you could do and about what education meant. Access to education was a little different in my parents' day. They both went to segregated schools. They said, you know, we will take advantage of these opportunities we're given through education. So that fuels me still.
I do want to note to Aquila, you were not named. what profession...
Really?
Outside of the one that you have, would you like to have attempted?
I think for me, nursing maybe. I do like to help people, and shout out to the nurses of our school district and, you know, and healthcare. They do a lot of work, and it's a lot of work that's, you know, physical but also mental, because they're there to be with patients and their families. So I think nursing would be mine. Career that I would want to attempt.
What prevented you from nursing?
At some, you know, when I was younger, I didn't really like to see blood. Mm. I've gotten over that. but yeah, I kind of ran away from blood, and you kind of need to be okay with blood in order to be a nurse. I said, no, that's probably not for me.
Well, we're glad you ran to us. We appreciate that.
I have not gotten over that. So, and I love a healthy debate. So I would say an attorney. Oh.
An attorney?
Yes.
Which branch of law? What would you have?
Really?
Yes.
There is always a question. You know, I could see myself being one who advocates for teachers and being a part of those, what do I want to say? We don't have unions here in Texas, but our teacher support programs, I could definitely see myself from being in the classroom and being a campus administrator who advocated for them, taking that to the courtroom as well. So I would say education law.
Dr. McGrew, education lawyer. That is a A&E primetime TV show somewhere. I know that's going to happen. Yeah, I do like that. Okay, a little bit more enjoyable. What movie do you enjoy quoting the most?
So I recently found out that there's a movie who actually has this quote, but the quote that I have and I live by is, there's a solution to every problem. So we just have to find it. And, you know, I did find out that apparently Philadelphia movie by Tom Hanks was the person who has this quote. So everything has a solution in life.
We just have to find it.
Yep.
It may not present itself right away.
No,
but if you keep learning and pushing.
Yep.
I like
push.
It.
So I wouldn't say that I had a favorite movie quote.
Boo.
Because I am a big The Office fan. So the philosopher who is Andy Bernard said, and you must know this show because yes. You giggled. I wish there was a way to know you were in the good old days before you actually left them. So even on challenging days, even if you feel like you're not meeting the moment, even if something takes your focus away just a little bit, it's still a good day. Like, still meet the moment, still live in the moment, still find something positive to hold on to, because the day is going to be gone. And if you miss that moment, you're done without it.
You pulled something very heartfelt from The Office.
You like that? I love that.
I mean, I would have quoted some Dwight or some Michael Scott.
Okay, don't.
Okay, what is your go-to karaoke song?
Growing up, we listened to Selena, Como la Flor. is my go-to karaoke song. And actually, we had karaoke Christmas, where we had a contest of who sang the song better. And I sang Como la Flor. Nice.
Did you win the contest?
We're going to say no, I did not. I felt like I was the host, so I need to give somebody else the opportunity to win.
Well, I'm the host today, so I'll give you the opportunity to win if you want to go ahead and...
I'm okay.
You're good? Okay.
Next time. You want to hear me sing absolutely nothing. However, I have never seen or heard anybody go wrong with Don't Stop Believing by Journey. So,
I don't know that song. Could you?
Really, Mr.
What's
Berger?
That song?
You want to hear me sing nothing. I led with that. I'll make sure you are exposed. I'll
yes,
send
ma'am.
It to you.
I want your version of it, though. Okay, final thought. Everything we do is focused on student growth and opportunity. What message would you like to give to all of our students?
I think that, focusing in school, but also building those relationships with your teachers, your students, your friends who, as Shayla has mentioned before, you most likely sometimes do keep up with those friends and years later you're going to remember those times. But focusing on school, to me, I always knew what I was going to go to school. I didn't know for what, but I knew that school was something that I was going to do.
I would say mindset matters. I think that you have to think you can before you actually can. You have to believe it before you're able to achieve it. I know all that sounds like, oh, heard that before. But I really do believe in that. And shout out to Aquila for always reminding me mind controls the body. So put that out there. Think you can, even if not yet, think you can.
Can you comment who Aquila is?
Aquila is my husband, who is also an educator.
Just in case listeners, because both Berger and you had brought him up. So,
well, he's pretty inspirational, but I agree with you. Make sure you're focusing on the present, focusing on the relationships, focusing on academics, and make sure you know in your mind you can achieve anything you put your mind to. Well, this concludes another exciting episode of the Building Blocks Podcast, and I hope that you understand. Yeah, I keep messing up that word. I hope that you understand how important it is if you want to be an educator, if you want to make a difference in the future of this world. It happens in the classroom each and every day. Come be a teacher in Pearland ISD and help us build Pearland proud. Don't forget to check out our website to add to our guest selections and audience question page. And we hope you enjoyed this episode. And remember, you can be a roadblock or you can be a building block. You can't always change what happens to you, but you can always change how you respond. Make it a great day or not, the choice is always yours. As always, your proud superintendent, and I hope to speak with you soon.